Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Brendan Hauser with EVOQ Bike. Welcome to Bike Radio. This is going to be more of a reaction video from Andy Coggan's podcast on Inside Exercise, where he talks a lot about this current obsession with Zone 2. I'm a huge fan of Zone 2 training. Zone 2 is endurance riding, what you can do all day long. And we have a ton of different videos on should you ride it 75%, should you ride it 65%, what's the difference? And I wanted to highlight some of the things that he talked about in this podcast, because I realize the podcast is over an hour and some people aren't going to listen to it. So let's talk about this podcast, because he lays out a lot of things and he's a man of the science. Dr. Coggan has a PhD. He's world-renowned exercise physiologist. He works at Indiana University. He wrote the book Training Racing with a Power Meter, which I've read probably 17 times literally. It helped me out a lot when I was understanding my own use of power when I started with it in 2009, I want to say, with Jason. And I was very surprised at some of the answers that he gave, which are not the most popular trends that people are talking about. So to have someone from the science not always saying the science is the best thing to follow, and actually quite opposite, I wanted to point out six things here. So in this video, we're going to talk about what does he talk about when, what really happens when you ride at one zone steady zone two, let's say. Talking about what he means as what is the best predictor of performance. Number three, power meter scientists. Number four, do we need to train in zone two to enhance and get better at burning fat, which is obviously a very important thing. I shouldn't say obviously, it's a very important thing in cycling. Number five, his comments on cardiovascular drift, and then bringing it all together, which I think is really the most important pieces here for us to all take away. Now, if this is your first time to the podcast, this is usually the shorter version of the podcast where we talk about things that my athletes are talking about, things from my own training. I ride a bike a lot, I've raced for a while, and it's just one person's thoughts. So take it as a grain of salt, take it as one thing that you absorb, and absorb a lot of other things also. And then on Tuesdays, we have World Tour cyclists, Olympians, the top level coaches. I've got a World Tour coach coming on. Those coaches, athletes, talking about their own training, their own coaching to help us all get faster. I am still racing. I'm still training. This is just an athlete who loves talking about cycling. So take this for what it is. I do not have a PhD. I have an MBA. I am not an exercise scientist. I'm more trained in business. So this is really coming from a curious athlete. Every once in a while, I get an email that's like, hey man, you're not an exercise physiologist. Why are you talking about this? I'm not telling you about studies that I've done because I haven't done any. I'm interpreting what these people are putting out for us as athletes to try to get faster. So that's just a quick disclaimer in case this is your first time here and you're wondering, who the hell is this dude? Why is he talking about this? I just love cycling and I'm just trying to get better. So Dr. Coggan is a numbers guy, right? And he has gone down the rabbit hole on power meter training, on training with heart rate. And so he has a ton of knowledge of this from probably day one when SRMs came out and whatever devices maybe were the prereqs of that. The one thing that he initially starts off on, and the host sort of really opened this up, is, hey, why is there so much zone two talk these days? And Dr. Coggan really starts off by saying, hey, if you stay in one zone, you become just a diesel engine. We don't ride a bike naturally steady state. You know, there's surges, you come out of a corner, there's times when you're pedaling, there's times when you're coasting. I honestly, at first, I was like, I don't really agree with that, because I, you know, kind of have, I don't want to say preached, but I have encouraged people to focus less on coasting on their endurance rides. Actually go pedal your bike. While I don't think you need to be obsessed with it, I started looking through, this really started when I was in Memphis, some people would hit me up, hey, can you look at my training? And they're coasting around for 40% of the ride. Their heart rate's dropping way down and they're just like chit-chatting. I'm like, you need to ride the bike. Andy says, steady is not how we ride bicycles and it's counterproductive to training. I disagree with that. I think you don't have to be riding that way all the time, but there's definitely benefit from going and pedaling your bike and staying in zone two. I don't think that's gonna make you become a diesel. What is my data or science to back it up? Performance, which is what he talks about. Those rides, I've had just the opposite come from athletes saying, these no-coast rides have helped me in my three-hour road race, because I can just see some people getting exhausted from non-stop. Like, if we're in a break and you're on the gas, you're not on the gas the whole time in a break, but you definitely don't have time to chill and coast. You might have a 45-minute section if you're all really ripping it and working together that you're on the gas, and it's just this non-stop pedaling that, from anecdotal evidence from athletes I've talked to and from myself, it's really important. So first in the podcast, I'm like, oh, I don't know if I'm going to really be into what this guy's talking about. Around minute 17, if you want to go into it, he then starts talking about the most important aspects of endurance performance is what he calls muscular metabolic fitness, or lactate threshold, FTP, versus cardiovascular fitness, which is what he refers to as our VO2 max. He starts to drill home the point that the best predictor of performance is performance itself. You don't want the tail wagging the dog, he says all the time. And so performance trumps all. And I'm like, this is interesting coming from a science guy. And he even talks about how it's really pointless to go get a one-time lactate test done, because what do you do with a one-time test? It's a benchmark to then refer back to, but going and getting a lactate test done one time, it depends on so many different things. And from Dr. Coggan, he says, people think that lab-based testing is the gold standard, and that is not true. Performance itself is the golden standard. Science is not the golden standard. And I don't want to come across in this podcast as being an anti-science guy or a bro scientist, but what I have said, and I have said it very cautiously and relatively quietly, that there are so many athletes now that I read through these forums, and they're like, someone might make a recommendation and say, well, where's the study for that? I don't understand where athletes are coming from thinking that there is a study for every type of training within an endurance sport. That is not, show me the study that a 6-hour ride is beneficial. Show me the study that these over-unders are better than something else. I mean, the science of how we adapt and what's going on in our bodies is so incredibly complex that to think we can peel back every single interval and what it does in a 12 to 16 week study under certain controlled circumstances is crazy when we say it that way, right? Like, learning something from a study is great, but then you have to apply it to your training and see what actually happens. And I think just this whole obsession with studies, you know, there's other YouTubers that say, let's look to the science. Sometimes they take just headlines, and if you actually look into the study, it's like 4 people that they did the study on. That's not really valid data, right? We don't want to be headline scientists either. So I think it is incredible to hear from a PhD, performance is what matters the most. So he goes on around minute 29:30. He recommends that we stop being power meter scientists and forget the physiology sometimes. Functional threshold power, FTP, what is actually functional, when how we use it, we should all be able to ballpark this. It's surprising when athletes overthink FTP. Is it 10 watts higher? Is it 10 watts lower? Am I exactly in the right place? It's like, it's going to change day to day. I think more importantly that we need to understand, how does that feeling of FTP change based on what you train? I don't like using myself as an example in this podcast, but I think this is a good moment to do so because I obviously know myself best from my own training. When I train too hard or do really short anaerobic intervals, or if I'm racing a ton, tons of max efforts, maybe it's just a big block of racing back to back, my ability to ride over threshold or at threshold definitely decreases, but I'm super sharp at hard efforts, hard bursts, can follow moves, can have the finishing punch. But in theory, we could say I've become more glycolytic. And it's balancing that, because I still need to be able to ride at threshold for the type of racing I do. I still need to be comfortable riding above threshold. I don't want to see it go down, but I can no doubt feel the difference between like a 415 FTP and a 400. And sometimes I'm at 400 and my anaerobic capacity in WKO is way higher, and I don't always trust what the computer algorithms tell me. That, and even my former coach Tom Bell was really big on, yeah, the number in WKO is important, but how do you feel? Do you feel like you can handle the surges? Do you feel like you're getting too sharp? And do you feel like riding an FTP is harder or are over-unders harder? Getting honed in on yourself is so important. And we're going to hear someone from Movistar talk about this in a couple weeks. The top coaches in performance are realizing that this obsession with power is not always making us faster. And I just think that's really important. You probably want to go listen to that part of this podcast around 29:30. Then the next big topic, do we need to sit in zone 2 to increase fat oxidation? He goes on around minute 37 to talk about how there's no perfect LT1 and LT2 breakpoints, and it's this continuum, and that there's this long-standing misconception around minute 39 that you need to oxidize fat to become better at oxidizing fat. Dr. Coggan says we're good at doing this without training. So here's what I found very, very interesting. He says that endurance training in general helps us to oxidize fat, but you don't need to do it to get better at it. These adaptations are primarily from and I'm reading this directly from the podcast, from an increase in mitochondrial respiratory capacity driven by an energetic state of the muscle during training and calcium release. And these things are what cause you to create more mitochondria, which then results in more fat oxidation capacity. What the hell does that all mean? That means that sitting in zone 2 to train and burn fat is not what makes us burn fat, is not what makes us increase mitochondrial density. Now, I'm not a scientist. I can't prove this. I'm just passing along the message. He takes some shots at Dr. San Millan because that guy is obviously going to say something very different. If you follow him, he's all about not surging. He says that if you go hard too often, does it affect fat burning and exercise? San Millan is going to say, yes, absolutely. It takes 20 to 30 minutes to reset your physiology. Dr. Coggan laughs at that and is like, no way, man. That's absolutely crazy. And so what he's talking about, and he says, you know, this is another big conception because, again, we don't have to oxidize fat to get better at oxidizing fat. He says, if you go hard and increase lactate, fatty acids will be suppressed. The theory was, therefore, that lactate suppressed fat burning. The real explanation is that fatty acids need blood flow to release them so that during high intensity exercise, the blood flow moves away from adipose tissue and you have lipolysis or fat breakdown, but the fatty acids cannot escape. Then when you go easier, the fatty acids rebound. This is a very hard study, he says, to study perfectly and requires really steady state training, so maybe it would need to be done indoors. So it really... plasma catecholamines have a very short half-life and are cleared so rapidly that he does not think it takes a very long time to reset your physiology when you go hard. But again, he says, who cares? Because you don't need to focus on burning fat to get better at burning fat. So that really opens, that's a very contradictory to what a lot of people are saying today. And I think I'm not here to say who's right and who's wrong, but I just wanted to highlight this because this podcast that he was on, I didn't really know much about it, but it had come across my radar and a couple people asked me questions on this, which is why I'm posting this podcast. And then the other thing I loved, he asked about cardiovascular drift and he says, hey, it's just a fact of life because your heart muscle is obviously going to fatigue and exercise. So over a 3-hour ride, yeah, the heart muscle is extremely fatigue resistant, but environment will change things. The amount of caffeine you've had will change things. The amount of sleep, there's so many factors that if you start to see some cardiovascular drift, that doesn't mean that you are unfit. And I 100% agree with that. I do not have athletes taper back the power when their heart rate starts to drift, because guess what? If you're not aerobically fit, I don't think that extra stress is going to overtrain you. It's going to train you and get it so you do have less cardiovascular drift down the road. If you're always backing down, then you're never training enough. And that's one man's opinion. So then towards the end, he really talks about minute 58. Pursue the type of training necessary to maximize the capabilities for your chosen event until you stop making forward progress. And then when you do stop seeing gains, change your training up, train something else, which we've talked about in this podcast, or go racing, right? At some point, we just posted a week ago, another bike radio. If you're losing motivation, if you feel like you're not making gains, sometimes you need to go race. Like the chasing the metrics has stopped. Go reap some fruits from your labor and then hit a reset button and go back and train again. It's just not train. I love training. But at some point, you got to do something with it. So wrapping this all up, can you just do anything you want, any type of training? No, I do not agree with that at all. We all are different, and that's part of this puzzle, is figuring out what do you need for the type of events that you're doing. We're not trying to become a 10 at everything. I'm never going to be a 10 at sprinting, but I'm going to become a 7 so that I can win out of a group. Find what your real weakness is and bump it up a little bit, double down on the strengths a little bit. How do these apply to your race? And take that package and move forward with it. Now, when we look at the big picture of training, I agree with Dr. Coggan. Even though these changes that happen in our body are extremely complex, keep it simple. Number two, have a training buddy. He goes into why you want to have a coach, and I'm not going to go into that because then it sounds like I'm pushing coaching. So I'm going to say have a training buddy. If you think, I've had people email me, and they'll say things like, well, I don't really need a coach for like to have a conversation with, etc. I just need the workouts. That's not coaching. If you've been coached and the coaching was just getting workouts, you had a bad coach. I'm sorry to say that. That is not coaching. Look at the science, but don't look at every study, because then it's going to have you jumping from one type of training to the next. Look at the performance, what's working for you. Be aware of what's going on and talk to your training buddy, or if you do have a coach, your coach, and see if it applies to your training. But keep things going in a logical progression forward, and science matters to an extent. But you know, if you're going to start really getting into the details of all these studies, make sure it's actually a useful study, not something with four people. That's not very useful, because guess what? That one of the four might not even be like you. So why would you apply it to yourself? Think big picture. And then I think, you know, asking the questions, can you train more? Can you train more optimally? Can you ride more? Don't get distracted by just all the talk. And the last thing that he says, sometimes the only way to know the right amount of training is go until you crack. Sometimes you hit the wall. James Piccoli, amazing, phenomenal pro, guy who's obviously really into his training, talked about sometimes you got to push up against that wall to find what that cliff is. And as you are training, things are going to change. What you're doing in year three of your training is probably going to be different than year six, because new things are going to come out, new ways of training, but also you change. And I've done so many different types of training to help me progress. I've always been looking at, okay, what's my weakness now? What's my weakness now? What's my weakness now? And that will change as you upgrade also. How I race as a three changes how I race at a regional Cat 1 race versus how I'm going to race at nationals this weekend. Like, you know, it's every strategy is not going to work for every race too. So this is a good place to stop. This one was kind of long. I think you should listen to this podcast, but hopefully you gained a lot of the information in less than 20 minutes. So we saved you 2/3 of the time. Maybe we'll try and get Dr. Coggan on the podcast here. That would be really awesome. If anybody knows him, hit him up. If you enjoyed this podcast and you're on Apple, please leave us 5 stars. Please follow on Spotify. That helps so much. And if you're watching on YouTube, please, please, please subscribe. Please tell a friend. Thanks for all you guys do. We greatly appreciate it. Talk to you soon. See ya.